Welcome, welcome. You're listening to 360 Info. I'm your host, Antonio. What you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. And what you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself. And what you know of yourself depends on what you've been told of yourself. Yes, please, hang in there, hang in there. We're getting close now. Been having some bone-chilling nights, but hey, you know, we know what to do. We just layer up, layer up, layer up, you know, and keep warm. But hang on there, we're getting through this. Hey, this is Saturday. Show Me the Money series. I'm going to keep it going for you for a little while to bring some good news that you can use about some financing, you know, because we tend to always be behind the eight ball when it comes to knowledge and information. It usually winds up costing us some money. So we got a great show for you today. We're going to be bringing you attorney Sam Thomas of Sam Thomas's law firm, and also brother Don Durrah from Don Durrah Appraisers. And we're going to talk a little bit dib and dab about some finances and how you can save a little money. But first, also, I want to remind you, get on board the train, the mind melt, you know, that I will be promoting sometime in June about how we can get together across the city and across the country. And we're talking to other people in other countries about getting together with this great mind melt that we can pray on peace and reconciliation, all right, so we can change some of that bad energy that is going on in the planet. In the remote studio, we got my co-host. That's what's going on.
18 degrees outside, man. We're in the midst of a polar vortex that seems to be lingering and lingering. I think I checked the weather forecast, and we might have a couple of 40-degree days in the upcoming week, and then it's going to go back to the brutal cold. So, you know, the predictions that they had for this winter, they were on point, because they said that we were going to get cold, we were going to get snow, and it was going to stay for a while. Spring can't come soon enough. But life in Cleveland, and life in Cleveland goes on. I'm really pleased to see the emphasis that's being placed on financial literacy and education right now. Folks who know me know that I've been involved in trading cryptocurrency and Forex for the past year and have seen some phenomenal gains, and I like to be able to share those opportunities for wealth building and passive income. So if you have an interest in making money while you sleep, if you have an interest in developing wealth, please reach out to a brother. You can reach me at THA_SOULPOET@yahoo.com. Again, that's THA_SOULPOET@yahoo.com. You can send me an email directly. You can also inbox me on Facebook, you know, Messenger. I don't use Messenger, but I do receive the messages that you send, and I'll keep my eyes open for that. And you can jump on this. It is a beautiful thing to get paid once, and some of us get paid twice a week. And it takes less than 2 minutes to do what you need to do after you get everything set up. So there it is, y'all. Passive income. You can take advantage of it. Reach out to a brother. Yes, we do have a great show lined up for you today. Sam Thomas, he's been around for a long time, practicing law and providing insight for those who need legal assistance. And we have Don Durrah, real estate appraiser, and we are looking forward to the information that they have to share with us today. So, Brother Hamtonio, who do we have up first? Is it Mr. Durrah?
Yeah, Brother Don Durrah. How you doing there, sir?
Fine. How are you?
All right, we hanging in there, trying to stay warm. You know, trying to stay warm, you know. But we're going to warm folks up with a little good information, you know, because money just tends to make people feel a little bit better, or at least, or even how to save a little bit, or how to get around and navigate through it, you know, the whole financial picture. So, Brother Don, I know you've been on the show before, and, you know, this is the time frame, you know, if people are going to decide to try to make some moves in dealing with some with their property taxes, you know, and a lot of times, a lot of our elderly, you know, may be sitting in a situation to where they even, you know, don't even have a mortgage, but is dealing with their property taxes going up on them, and you know, each year, or even people, as far as their mortgages is concerned, the property taxes going up, and you know, the county's coming out and assessing, you know, that particular area. And then the property taxes go up, but there is something that we can do about that. You know, if you get, and maybe in a little disagreement on the tax assessment that is given to you by the county. So, Don, that's how you help people. So tell us what's going on, what we can do, and what's the time limit that we're dealing with.
Well, first of all, this is not only for the elderly. It's for anyone who owns property. People make assessments of your property, and they make mistakes. And they send appraisers out from the county, or sometimes the appraisers don't even come out. They do what's called modeling. If one house on that block is worth X amount of dollars, then they say, yeah, all the houses are worth X amount of dollars. Mm-hmm. So now is the time, every year between January and March 31st, you, the homeowner, has an opportunity to say to the county, I think you made a mistake. Did they do it purposely? No. They just made a mistake. And the only one that's going to be hurt or affected by the mistake that they make is you. And as soon as you bring it to their attention, they'll correct it. But if you don't bring it to their attention, it won't be corrected. And you'll just go on. Now, you have from this is called a trilennium. And this is the first year of the trilennium. So if you've ever filed to oppose your taxes before, you can do it again this year. But once you do it this year, you can't do it again for the next 3 years.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, like I said, it's nothing intentional. It's the fact that when you do so many properties, all the properties in Cuyahoga County, you're bound to make a mistake.
Mm-hmm. You know, Don, see, you know, again, you know, like I stated before when we, you know, opened up the show that, a lot of times, you know, our folks, African-Americans, tend to, you know, not to be privy to a lot of information and of knowing, you know, that they can actually challenge, you know, the appraiser, you know, in a way that can benefit them like that, you know. And so I guess that's the norm, it seems like to me, you know, when dealing with our folks in a lot of ways, especially financially, you know. Because we tend to be not always in the know, you know, and it usually causes us some money not being in the know, you know. So, yeah. and for us to understand and know that we can actually, you know, challenge that situation, you know. So that's a good thing. Good thing. So how do you lead people by the hand, Don? What do you exactly do to, can you tell us a little bit how that?
Well, there's a form online. And if anybody wants to call me, I think you gave – I don't know if you gave them my number or not. If anybody wants to call me, they can call me, and I could walk them through it. There's a form online that you fill out simply saying, County, you said my property was worth $100,000, and I feel it's only worth $60,000. So I want to appeal – your thought of my value. And in that appeal, you get an appraiser. An appraiser appraises your house. They take it down to the county, and they sit before – well, they don't do that now. They do it on Zoom. You sit before three hearing officers, and you plead your case that I had an appraisal, and the appraiser said the property is worth $60,000. You said it's worth $100,000. I would like that changed.
Mm. And Don, before we go into a break, I guess we're going to go into the break, though. But Don, when you come back, you know, I want to go over that process and the time frames and what some of the listeners are looking to expect, you know, and how much of a drop can you, because you gave that scenario of 100,000 to 60,000, you know, is that actually doable and possible? But we're going to go into a break. Take us to a break, man.
Yeah, I also wanted to testify because I've been through the process a few times, but the times that I went through it, I actually had to go to the county administration building and the new structure that they have right now, and you sit before the Board of Revision. There are three hearing officers right there, and you plead your case with them, and then they get back with you, and you get a result. So it's not as intimidating as it might seem, but it is something that is available to you, and I'm grateful to Mr. Durrah for bringing that information to us, because I'm going, either I'm going down there, I'm going to sit in front of my laptop and I'm going to say, hey, y'all got it wrong. Let's get it right. You're listening to 360 Info Network right here on AM 1490 WERE with Hamtonio and Vince Robinson. Our guest at the moment is Don Durrah. He's a real estate appraisal specialist and professional, and he's going to give us some guidance as to how you can confront the county and get your property evaluated properly. We'll be right back after these messages.
Hi, I am Frances Caldwell, Executive Director of the African American Museum, welcoming you to join us as we continue to rebuild, grow, develop, and help the community. In addition to the rich historical exhibits we have, we are offering community education, cultural opportunities to enhance our children, including free dance and business classes. The African American Museum celebrates over 60 years as America's oldest independent Black museum. And as our founder, Ichabod Fluellen, intended, we are heading for higher heights and renew community education, history, and culture. You can contribute to the success of this valued institution by becoming a member. To make your $35 yearly membership pledge, Cash App, $AAMCLE. For more information, please visit our website at AAMCLE.org or call 216-721-6555. Thank you for your support of Cleveland's African American Museum.
Greater Cleveland's largest selection of African fashions, African art, jewelry, picture frames, and African furniture accessories from the heart of Africa are located at African Art, 16700 Chagrin Boulevard, Shaker Heights, Ohio. Give them a call at 216-269-7421. Enjoy their spacious showroom and gallery and enhance yourself in your home with African art and cultural clothing, fine art, home, and personal accessories. For a limited time, for our 360 Information Network listeners, for every $50 purchase, receive a free handcrafted African fabric mask for personal wear. Our quality is impeccable and our inventory will meet your need. Open Mondays through Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Enhance your life with African art.
We're back. 360 Info Network with Hamtonio, Vince Robinson, and our guest at the moment, Don Durrah, real estate appraiser and specialist, giving us insight on how we can properly get our property taxes adjusted. Brother Hamtonio.
Yeah, Brother Don. What do you give us, our listeners, some of the examples of some of the cases that you have worked on, and letting them know that, I guess, the Zoom, by them doing the hearings via Zoom, that you'll still be a part of that process?
Yes. Well, in the Zoom, you don't go down and sit physically before the hearing officers. You can be on the telephone. You can be on the computer. At computer, you can see, everybody can see each other. On the telephone, they can't see you, but they can hear you. And you could plead your case that way. The best thing is to have the evidence. They're looking for evidence for what you're saying. And the evidence is an appraisal. Other evidence you can have, I had a situation where a person bought a house 5 months ago, and they paid $75,000 for the house. When they got their taxes, they made a mistake. They said the house was worth $125,000, but they just bought the house for $75,000.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens? And I want to warn people: what you can get caught up is in pride, and everybody's proud that look how much my house is worth. You know, they said it's worth $125,000. Boy, am I rich now. I got a house worth $125,000. I only owe 50 on it, I'm great. But the secret is, try to sell that house for 125. It will not sell. It will not sell. But in the meantime, you're paying taxes on 125. So you're just giving money away.
Don, if I could ask you this question quickly, is there a disadvantage to having a lower property tax rate if you have an interest in selling your property? Or is it a case where it's the market value that dictates, the true market value that dictates the value of your house, and it may not hurt you to have a lower tax rate?
You don't have... I've been in real estate since 1963. I'm a real estate broker. I'm a real estate appraiser. I taught real estate and appraisal at college for the last 20 years. For 20 years, not the last 20 years. I teach classes now, even online. You don't have a value until you're ready to sell. Today, your property can be worth $100,000. When you go to put it on the market, it can be worth $60,000 for some reason. It went down. Tomorrow, your property can be worth $60,000, and you go to put it on the market, and everybody wants that house and wants that area, it could be worth $125,000. It can go up and down, but you cannot tell the true value until you put it on the market and test the market to see what you can get. So in the meantime, while you're standing there and you have no intentions of selling, you need to have the lowest value possible that your property is worth.
Okay.
Because you're paying taxes on that money. You're paying taxes on that value. And if it's not a true value, you're wasting money.
You're paying for basically. You're paying to say, yes, well, I pay so much for property taxes, and it's really coming out of your pocket.
Right. Exactly.
Right. Hey, Don, you know, before we let you go and give people your information, I guess it's very important for you to know, you know, the area as well as far as houses is concerned, because when I was in the real estate business, too, that, you know, it depends on how long you're going to keep the house, I guess, because you can only do so much to the house that's going to actually increase the value of it. Sometimes people get to putting too much in the house, and you won't be able to recoup that value that you put back in the house. So it's all dependent on, you know, if you plan on staying there for a while and all that, that's fine. But that's an issue that I think that, you know, you really got to, you know, take and think about when and owning the property as far as making improvements. And when you answer that question, also, home ownership can be a serious responsibility and really be costly to people. And so especially when you have to do some underground work or having to put in a water line and stuff like that, or gas line, whatever. Don, can you quickly talk about some other programs or other things that homeowners can do to save themselves some money and some grief?
Yeah. If you go through your gas company or your water company, they have programs that will add like $5 or $6 onto your water bill every month. And then if you ever have a problem, water line, sewer backup, anything like that, it's done automatically. It's done. In other words, it's like an insurance policy that you pay $5 a month or $6 a month on your water bill. And then if you have a problem, you call them and say, look, I have a problem. Could you help me? And they'll send somebody out, they'll investigate it, and they'll do it for free. I've had my sewer back up twice. Once amazing, it was right before Thanksgiving. They came out that Wednesday and opened that sewer up, and I didn't pay a dime.
Mm-mm-mm.
That's called HomeServe. It's called HomeServe Plan, and you can get that through your water company. And you can get it on your furnace, your hot water tank, your electrical system, your plumbing system. You know, you're covered.
Is that like five a piece, or is it different?
For each item, it's about $5 or $6.
Wow.
The furnace is a little more because it's a little more expensive item.
Mm-hmm.
If they cannot fix it, they'll replace it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that seems like something that I think a lot of us can get on board with, you know, because that could be very costly. And again, we tend to not to know about that, or even not to, you know, take that risk and be involved. And then there you go. You know I had to do it one time. Somebody digging up your front lawn, but, you know, and then it's costing you well over $1,000 or so to get that done. Well, Don, I appreciate you coming on. If people want to get in contact with you and talk about this a little bit more and you can, you know, help guide them, you know, through this process, we definitely want to, you know, give you some play and connect these people with you so they can save some money. How can they get in contact with you, Don?
Okay. My number is, and this goes straight to my cell phone, is 216. I told you I've been in business since 63, so I'm not a big text man or a big email guy. I'm a telephone guy. Call me and talk to me. So it's 216-231-2564. That's 216-231-2564.
Donnie,
and again, I say you have from now until March 31st to get this in. And that after March 31st, you have to wait till the next year.
Don, do you have a website by chance?
I have a website, Durrah the Appraiser, and I have Durrah 2 Real Estate. I have two websites. Because my daughter and kids told me I needed a website, so I got a website.
So it's Don. It's DurrahTheAppraiser.com?
Yes.
Okay. The reason that
it's
I asked Durrah
2 Real Estate or Durrah 2 Real Estate, the same phone numbers on both. So.
Okay. The reason that I asked the question is that there may be people who are interested in finding more out about those programs that will provide insurance for your sewer system and those various appliances that you talked about. Is there any information available on those websites to direct folks to those resources?
No, but I can give them a telephone number.
Okay.
For that is 1-855-336-2465.
Okay.
I just,
one. Yeah, I have it. 1-855-326-2465.
Three three six.
336-2465. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I just posted the phone number. I'm going to give more information about that, and also posted your website to the Facebook page, and we'll put this on the 360 Info Network Facebook page so people will have a place to go to get access to these resources. We really appreciate the insight that you provided for us this morning, and we look forward to getting those property taxes adjusted based on the insight that you provided. Thanks for joining us on 360 Info Network, Brother Don.
Okay, thank you. Anytime you need something, give me a call.
All right,
Brother Don. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Appreciate you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay, fine.
All right.
It's 11:30 here on AM 1490 WERE. You're listening to 360 Info Network with your hosts, Hamtonio, and yours truly, Vince Robinson. We are looking to be joined by attorney Sam Thomas on the other side of this break, and we will be right back after these messages.
Hi, I am Frances Caldwell, Executive Director of the African American Museum, welcoming you to join us as we continue to rebuild, grow, develop, and help the community. In addition to the rich historical exhibits we have, we are offering community education, cultural opportunities to enhance our children, including free dance and business classes. The African American Museum celebrates over 60 years as America's oldest independent black museum. And as our founder, Ichabod Fluellen, intended, we are heading for higher heights and renew community education, history, and culture. You can contribute to the success of this valued institution by becoming a member. To make your $35 yearly membership pledge, Cash App, $AAMCLE. For more information, please visit our website at AAMCLE.org or call 216-721-6555. Thank you for your support of Cleveland's African American Museum.
Greater Cleveland's largest selection of African fashions, African art, jewelry, picture frames, and African furniture accessories from the heart of Africa are located at African Art, 16700 Chagrin Boulevard, Shaker Heights, Ohio. Give them a call at 216-269-7421. Enjoy their spacious showroom and gallery and enhance yourself in your home with African art and cultural clothing, fine art, home, and personal accessories. For a limited time, for our 360 Information Network listeners, for every $50 purchase, receive a free handcrafted African fabric mask for personal wear. Our quality is impeccable and our inventory will meet your need. Open Mondays through Saturdays, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. Enhance your life with African art.
Welcome back to 360 Info Network with Hamptonio and yours truly, Vince Robinson. Our guest at this moment is attorney Sam Thomas. He just told us 25 years of practicing law. He's going to shift from the courtroom to the classroom. We're really looking forward to the knowledge that he's about to drop on us right now. Welcome to 360 Info, attorney Sam Thomas. Hamptonio.
Brother Thomas, how you doing there?
Hey, my pleasure, and thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of this educational forum. I'm looking forward to the exchange.
Yeah, brother. You know, again, like we, you know, have mentioned earlier, that I know you see it all the time, you know, going to the courtroom and, you know, just being in the, you know, the people business, you know, and sometimes sometimes it's hard to take your feelings out of dealing with, you know, especially our people, seeing them getting involved in situations that, you know, you're trying to get them out of, you know, and still in one piece. And I know over the course of 25 years, you got a lot that you can talk about on how, you know, to proceed further in dealing with law and things like that. But this time we're going to talk a little bit about more about how we can save some money through owning, you know, far as their estates is concerned. Because it's a sad state of affairs when, just take for instance, a person is, you know, lived in a house for 30 years, and at this point, they failed to produce a will, or, you know, they fall back on their taxes or things of that nature, and the kids or the siblings or whatever, you know, fail to, you know, obtain the property, you know, at least maybe in a timely manner, and the courts get involved and things like that. So that becomes a sad state of affairs. So we're going to touch on that and a little bit about how we can ward off and some things in dealing with a trust. So Sam, take it away.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's a big picture and scope of services that I have performed over these 25 years, both in the criminal and the civil court arena, probate, and all the different areas of law. There are approximately 18 areas of law, and I practice in most of them, including divorce, et cetera. But, you know, everything, in my opinion, at this point, comes down to risk management. Risk management. And, Lynn, as you talk about, you know, the house, you know, that might get taken away from the person that's owned it for 30 years and suddenly, you know, they pass away or they still are, you know, amongst us. Somehow taxes might build up to an amount that they might not have enough money as a lump sum to pay. Well, then, you know, there's a remedy for that, even before it gets to foreclosure for that elderly person or even a younger person losing that house. Yeah, it might be worth $100,000, and the taxes only be about $5,000 or $6,000. But they run the risk of losing that house if they don't get the right guidance. And what I normally do is work out with the Treasurer's Department with the Cuyahoga County a payment plan where they can pay their current amount as an additional amount in order to make up for that arrearages that has accrued. Now, a lot of people don't know that service is available to them. So getting the right kind of legal advice and education can go a long way in preserving those assets. But just getting back to the whole concept of the umbrella term I use, risk management. What we're talking about is making decisions about your financial future and protecting your assets, whether it's your home, your business, your cars, your monetary investments. All of those things are constantly at risk if you don't manage them appropriately. So what I do, again, with the umbrella of risk management, is I help individuals, I help businesses, I help couples to estate plan. And it's a way to preserve their assets and their estate to create generational wealth. And there are a number of different ways in order to do it, but it all depends on, what the makeup of the estate is. You know, some people will just have one home, and they want to make sure that home, gets into the hands or the possession of whom they want it to be in possession of it. There are a number of different ways to do it. There's what's called a TOD, or a transfer on death. And one of the beautiful things about a transfer on death for a home or any other kind of real estate is to do what's called a transfer on death. And the advantage of that is it avoids probate. If you don't have a lot of assets in your estate, and you can avoid, the probate process, which can be timely and also expensive, you can do the transfer on death. If you're talking about bank accounts or other financial instruments, you can do what's called a payable on death. Arranging that with the bank and, again, avoiding probate. So there are a number of different things, but the big picture is, establishing an estate. And the estate, can speak for you, while you are living in terms of getting the money or getting the assets the house, the cars, or whatever, out of your name during your lifetime. And some people find that doing that is a wise thing to do because they're on Medicaid or they have some other creditor that, might show up upon their death. Well, with Medicaid, there's a five-year look-back period. So let's take the example. You've got a house, and the house is paid for. The house is worth $225,000. Well, with catastrophic illness, that person can run up a bill of over $1 million of hospital and nursing home stay that Medicaid will pay for. But Medicaid will want to be reimbursed for that out of your estate at the end of your life. Well, putting your property, taking it out of your name for that five-year look-back period, is a way to avoid that risk management, the risk of Medicaid, taking over your entire estate. Well, putting it in a trust or putting it in just out of your name for that period of time. Everybody has a different situation. and I've got an extensive questionnaire that will allow me to create an inventory of what that person has in their estate, and I can advise them as to what to do. The people that I have been dealing with, there have been probably 5% of the people that come to me have warranted an estate. Most of them have, we can meet their goal by doing other types of instruments, like the transfer on death or the transfer on, or the POD payable on death. Make sure that you have beneficiaries for your insurance policy, because if you don't, within, in order for anyone next of kin to get the benefit of that life insurance policy, it will have to go through probate in order for the courts to distribute, you know, what is in that life insurance policy. If you don't have a beneficiary on that bank account, whether it's savings, checking, CD, if you don't have beneficiaries on those, well, then those things have to be turned over to the probate court in order to distribute, to legally distribute those items. So again, back to the inventory. It gives me a snapshot of exactly what's in the estate and how to best go about risk managing the assets that's in that estate.
Sam, if you could, I think it's really important for folks to understand the implications of property and resources going to probate. Give the listeners an idea of how much they stand to lose if they let things go to probate versus taking the proactive approach and securing your assets before it gets to that.
Well, let's say if you're being proactive, Vince, your question, you know, really screams, be proactive. You've got, you know, this, you know, list of assets. To whom do you want those assets to go? It does two things. It makes sure that, well, you want to couple that along with perhaps a last will and testament. Okay, that sort of reiterates that you want the house to go to, you know, your son, or you want the house to go to whomever. Well, again, you can do the transfer on death, and that makes sure that that person gets it without going through probate. Without having, so one thing that can happen, you won't necessarily lose the property out of your line of succession, your heirs, but what you might create is a situation where you got family members that are next of kin saying that she told me or he told me that she or he wanted me to have this. So it creates a lot of animosity among the heirs, and instead of them worrying about, you know, giving the person a decent home going, a loving one, you know, there's just so much tension that's going on. So that's a biggie, and I see that a lot, and it really depreciates the quality of life by those emotional things. Versus, you know, not being able to get a $5,000 or $10,000 bequeath, you know, from the person that died. So I think the most important thing, you know, that's gained by being proactive and managing your risk appropriately is taking the steps, you know, that we're talking about.
Okay, you know what, Sam? You see that too often, you know, that you know, not taking a proactive approach have destroyed families, you know, to where folks are not, to, you know, for years haven't spoke to one another because of things like that. So, and in doing that, you know, as far as cost is concerned, just setting that up, it's probably a good, minimal cost that you can get that set up with. And just look at how much the rest and everything else that can be curtailed, you know, just by taking that approach of getting those things down. So basically, Sam, you know, if someone wanted to come and talk to you, I guess you would just tell them, hey, man, take the time, sit down and talk to your, you know, let's say if it was like a person that was like a guardian of their the mother, or caretaker, rather, you know, so of their parents or taking care of watching. So they just basically sit down and just iron this thing out and just get it done, huh?
Absolutely. You know, let me know what you're dealing with. And once I find out what you're dealing with and what's your level, something you just said brought into mind, you know, if the person is incompetent, then what we do is we establish, you know, somebody that will become their guardian and manage an appropriate person that won't, you know, perpetrate, taking all that person's money. But, you know, we establish that guardian, and that guardian will be appointed by the court with the advice and consent of the rest of the family. It's not done in a vacuum. Who is the most appropriate person? Who is trustworthy to manage, you know, this incompetent person's estate? You know, that's very important. But there are a lot of different instruments that are involved that can be put in place to help secure that person's finances and their financial future, and make sure that their assets are preserved and those assets are distributed and bequeathed as they wish. And one of the most important things to do is to make sure you have a last will and testament, because if you die without a last will and testament, well, then the state has what's called the law of descent and distribution. And there's a cascading range of a descending list of individuals, you know, that will be next in line to be the beneficiary of your stuff. Well, you might have a cousin in there that might be pretty high up on, you know, that distribution list. You haven't seen that cousin in, you know, 10 years, and they've been ostracized from the family, and rightfully so. So without a last will and testament, the state can look at that person's heirs and say, okay, there's no spouse. Okay, there are no parents. There are no sisters and brothers. Well, next in line, you know, we go to the children of sisters and brothers or whatever. And, you know, that's where that distant cousin, you know, might be in line. And you never in your life would want, you know, your estate or any part of your estate to go to that person.
Okay, so that really gets to the question that I was asking about those implications. You want to make sure that the property goes to the appropriate person, and if you don't act proactively, then the state is going to make that decision for you. I'm curious, Brother Sam, about the idea of an irrevocable trust and the difference between setting up an irrevocable trust versus setting up a last will and testimony. Is there an advantage to setting things up as a trust, and is there, a legal aspect to it that you would be involved in?
Yes. The irrevocable trust is the instrument that is the most powerful for an individual that has a sizable estate and they want to keep it out of the reach of creditors. You know, they may have a business, you know, that, you know, they're, you know, making millions and millions of dollars and have accrued, you know, millions, hundreds of millions of assets that would be susceptible to being taken, you know, by any kind of creditor that's out there, if it's in that person's name or in that person's business name, etc. Well, an irrevocable trust owning that property, those assets, You know, it keeps it out of the name of the business. It keeps it out of the name of the individual. And it's an asset protection device versus a revocable trust. Well, the revocable trust doesn't have that same kind of protection away from creditors. It does take it out of the name of, you know, the person who might own it, but it doesn't, under the law, provide that same kind of separation of ownership as an irrevocable. Because, you know, you make up an irrevocable trust, you can't change it. With a revocable trust, I mean, you can change it just as the name, you know, connotes. It's revocable. So that's an overview of those two instruments versus a last will and testament. But see, the last will and testament does not become operable until the person dies. And it says that, okay, the house I own, I want it to go to, well, by law, if there's a surviving spouse, then, you know, it would go to that spouse. And but there's a way to do it so that you don't have to go through probate. What you do is, you know, you create a will that upon the death of one of the parties or one of the husband or the wife, well, then it automatically goes to the surviving spouse. It's called a survivorship deed. And the only thing you have to do with that deed that has the word survivorship in it is take that along with the death certificate of the deceased spouse, you know, take that, you know, to the recorder's office. And no pun intended, but the deed is done, as opposed to having to go to probate court, get a certificate of transfer. It's just short of opening up an estate, but, you know, it involves, you know, a lot of money compared to the money that it would take just to, you know, get a death certificate, fill out the form to transfer under that survivorship deed. So I wanted to distinguish between irrevocable and revocable trust. Now, under either one of those two trusts, let's just say that, you know, you want to give your 17 or even your 25-year-old some maintenance income. They're in college or whatever, or they have their own home, but their job doesn't pay them the amount of money that you want them to earn. They want to earn in order to live a certain level of life. Well, then that trust and the trustee could disperse out of that trust that has, you know, millions of dollars in it, a certain amount of money, you know, to that 17-year-old, to that 22-year-old who just finished college or somebody that's in college, a maintenance allowance, you know, for that. And that's what's called a spendthrift feature that can be built into a trust. Now, you say, you know, intuitively you might say, well, that's a good idea, because if I give this 22-year-old, you know, $500,000, you know, they're going to rock the world with that, and by the time mm-hmm. they're, you know, 25, they're not going to have a cent.
Right.
So the spendthrift feature, you know, helps you to manage, you know, your money, you know, while you're still on this earth and even after you leave. You know, I've, you know, worked with people that have, you know, developed trust, and the money is dispersed throughout the lifetime of, you know, the next person. And because, so that's my response to the question of kind of distinguishing trust versus a last will and testament.
Yes.
Right, because it's always good. Like us, you know, we should always really start this financial literacy course when the kids are young, because more often you always see that if you were to lead a kid something and they don't have a good knowledge base and foundation of financing and monies and investments like that, all that work you did in saving and building, they tend to squander because they don't know and understand the value of finances and the dollars. And so always, please, let's start educating our children early on about financing and financial literacy.
That's a good word, squander. And, you know, we can, you know, a person's assets can be squandered in so many ways. But the biggest way that it's squandered is not having sound financial advice and being proactive, you know, as you said earlier. And, you know, and that's where the, you know, the questionnaire that I do comes into play. You know, I get a snapshot of what's in that person's estate. I get an opportunity to see what, you know, their debt to, you know, asset ratio is at this point, and whether or not we need to do something in order to protect, you know, even their wages. I have a lot of people that call me, you know, they might have, you know, a pretty sizable estate, but that estate is in jeopardy because, you know, their current, their creditors are not being paid. And their creditors are not being paid because, you know, their income is not, you know, consistent or equal to their expenses.
Okay.
Then I can, you know, here's the things they can do at that point. Yes.
Okay. We're winding down in terms of time. I do have your website pulled up on my computer. I see st3attorney.com and a phone number of 216-303-8402. Is that still current?
That is not current. That's not a current website.
Okay. What is your website and your telephone number?
Okay. ST3attorney.com.
Okay. ST3attorney.com is the website, and the telephone number is
216-229-1521.
1521. Got you locked in. We will put this information on the Facebook page so that folks can reach out to you if they want to set up that trust or the last will and testimony, whatever they need to do to be proactive and avoid probate court. Sam Thomas, thank you for joining us on 360 Info Network today.
Thank you, Antonio and Vince. Appreciate it.
All right.
Thank you, my brother.
Brother.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Got about a minute. Any last minute announcements you want to get out?
Yeah, basically good. Good. Yes, I appreciate that from these two guys. And, you know, we're going to try to keep it going at Show Me the Money series. Again, if you're interested in being a part of this mind melt, I've been talking to people across the country, so we get some good response. So y'all stay tuned. I'll be bringing you more. And if you got some questions, 216-323-6155. 216-323-6155.
All right. And if you'd like to be connected with an income-producing opportunity, passive income, weekly pay, give me a holler, THA_SOULPOET. That's THA_SOULPOET@yahoo.com. Let a brother hook you up. Thanks to our engineer, Tristan Sanchez, for pulling everything together, making us sound good on the radio. And thank you for listening. This is 360 Info Network. Know yourself, love yourself, be yourself. Make today your best day. Peace.
Peace.